This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a friend and guest on the show in the form of Trisha O'Hehir. Trisha and I are going to talk about some state-of-the-art prevention concepts and how to successfully implement a stronger prevention protocol in your practice. You're going to love the interview that I did with Trisha. I think we can all agree that helping prevent future problems is something that we're certainly committed to at my practice at Life Smiles, and I'm sure you're committed to that and to your practice as well. And I know you're going to find lots of cool information in this interview I did with Trisha O'Hehir. But before I get to that interview, I'm going to introduce a new segment to the Thriving Dentist Show. If you've been following along for the last couple months, you have noticed the top clinical tips segment we've done with Dr. Leanne Brady. Well, I'm going to introduce another segment that's kind of similar to that, and this is with my great friend, Dr. David Hornbrook. So David and I have been friends for many, many, many years. Most of you will probably recognize David Hornbrook. If you don't, you'll be thrilled to get a chance to meet him through the segment that we're going to introduce here on the Thriving Dentist Show. But I'm going to introduce a segment called Ask David. Ask David. We've received questions from clinical materials questions, perhaps even equipment questions. We've received a variety of questions from our listeners over the years, and we're going to start a segment called Ask David, where I will recount one of the questions that we've received from our listeners, and David will answer that. And over the next little while, we're going to kind of alternate back and forth between a top clinical tip segment from Dr. Leanne Brady or an Ask David segment from Dr. David Hornbrook. So without any further ado, let's get to our very first Ask David segment of the Thriving Dentist Show. Today's Ask David question is one that I think will be of great interest to all of you. Dr. Hornbrook, is it time to buy a digital scanner?
Wow, that is a good question. I would say absolutely yes. You know, you look at the technology today, and we know digital scanners for impressions, whether it be for fixed or removable or ortho, is more accurate than we see with polyvinyl. We get more accurate representation of certainly gingival embrasures and soft tissue as well. So, yeah, absolutely. You know, initially we didn't have many choices. Originally it was you either had a CEREC, you didn't, and you were either a digital dentist or you weren't based on that. And now you look at there's some major players in this field of intraoral scanners. CEREC is still there. Personally, I think 3-shape is the best. The Trios by 3-shape I think is the best. The potential problem with that is if you're an Invisalign doc, so if you're doing a lot of Invisalign, and you say, I think I'm going to get a 3-shape digital scanner, you don't have that option because they, as we say, don't play well together in the sandbox. But, you know, a whole other topic, Gary, is there's a lot of other clear aligner companies that are coming out that will play with all the different scanners. So my question is really, what are your goals with this? Do you want it for fixed, crown and bridge only? Do you want to do removable? Because we're getting to the point now where, I mean, literally we could scan for dentures. Do you want to do implants and use scan bodies for the implants? You know, there's different scanners will do different things. I will tell you, and based on my experience in the laboratory, is that the laboratory prefers digital impressions more than polyvinyl. And really, if we look at the way technology's changed, is we're not using slide rules anymore. We're using computers. We're using polyvinyl impressions when we have digital scanners and digital impressions available. It just doesn't make any sense. It's much more accurate. It's quicker. You know, the polyvinyl, other than being a little bit more hydrophilic, really hasn't changed in the last 30 years. But we're still using that. And what I think is the most important thing we do in dentistry is impressions so we can get an accurate fit of indirect restorations, our most expensive thing we do. So I think it's absolutely time. I think it's imperative that the clinician, as they look at these different scanners, have them in your office, play with them, look at price, because there's huge price differences from $16,000 to almost $50,000, depending on what you're looking for. But absolutely, I think it's going to save you money. A lot of dentists, and I know a lot of your listeners especially, are using labs and aren't down the street. They're mailing their case to a laboratory. Lots of laboratories will split the mailing fee with you, the shipping fee. They'll pay one way, you pay one way. So, I mean, that's a minimum of $10, $10 to $15. If we can scan and send the scan overnight, I mean, immediately, then we eliminate instantly off our lab bill $10 to $15. And also turnaround time is huge. You know, no one likes to deal with the provisional aspect of it, but laboratories need a certain time in order to pour up your models, fabricate the restoration, ship it back to you. You know, if we can do it digitally where they get the impression immediately and it's a file, especially if we do modelless. You know, again, that's a whole other topic. But, I mean, why do we have models in dentistry? I mean, we have them because we like to look at our preps, basically. And we know that digital impressions are more accurate. We know the restorations fit better. And we can, again, save on lab bill, which is huge in this environment of economics and trying to keep our overhead low. If we can lower our lab bill by not having models by $10 to $20, depending on laboratory, you know, all of a sudden we're looking at a restoration, even at a great lab, to be equivalent of what traditionally we paid for with an inexpensive or a mass-produced laboratory.
David, you provided me an insight that I'd like you to share with our listeners on this, because I'm sure there's some listeners that are thinking about this. There might be some listeners that are sitting on the fence thinking, well, there's going to be some new technology coming down the pike. Should I just wait till the new technology comes to the digital scanners? You shared a great insight with me. Would you mind sharing your insight with our listeners?
Well, I'm not sure exactly what you're talking about, as we talked earlier, but, you know, things are changing, but if you don't adopt technology now, you're going to be way behind the eight ball, way behind the curve. You know, it'd be like right now I'm looking at a computer and I'm thinking, you know, next year I'm not going to have this computer anymore because it's going to be better. Do I throw this away and go back to taking notes with a pen on a piece of paper just because technology is changing? You know, you can buy a scanner today, honestly, and ease of use is huge. It used to be very difficult with the early scanners, and that's why a lot of people did not adapt to them because the software was difficult to use. They weren't very accurate. Their images had a very narrow field of focus. Now that's all changed. So the learning curve is low. You could buy a scanner today, and I almost guarantee this, you could throw it away in 1 year, and you would have paid for it, not only in savings from your lab bill, but also in the accuracy of your restoration, less time seating your restorations, better fits, occlusion. I mean, there's good studies on this where there's less need to do a closal adjustment, proximal contacts, marginal adjustment. I mean, yes, we should buy a scanner. And yes, you're not going to have that scanner you buy today 5 years from now. That's just not going to happen. But we're used to throwing away technology. Our cell phone, you know, my iPhone 7, you know, should I not have a cell phone because iPhone 10 is going to be better and I should go back to having a pager and a landline and using, you know, phone booths? Absolutely not. Because we need to adopt technology because we benefit from that. And then as the technology evolves, we evolve.
I knew our listeners would appreciate your perspective. Thanks, David.
It was my pleasure.
Well, earlier I mentioned that my guest on this Thriving Dentist Show is my friend Trisha O'Hehir. Hey, Trisha, how are you?
Great. Nice to be here.
You know, we are doing this live. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you know we don't normally do this live. But I've had the wonderful opportunity to spend some time with Trisha on the Smiles at Sea Alaska cruise. Are you having as much fun as I am?
I am. Absolutely.
Oh, wait a minute. We're working.
Oh, yes, that's right. But
we're working. We're working.
How bad can it be looking out the window at the ocean?
Yeah, that's our story. We're sticking to it. But we have been working throughout this throughout this cruise. I am excited to hear your presentation coming up on Saturday morning.
Looking forward to it. 8 a.m.
Yes. So let's give some recognition to our friend Elijah Desmond, from the founder of Smiles at Sea. We're literally on the very first Alaska cruise. 7 days. It has been amazing. The cruise, the people, the excursions. A couple hours ago, we were in Glacier Bay National Park. How about that?
That was amazing.
Yeah, really, really amazing. And having a great time. If you're interested in education that combines fun and very serious education, take a look at Smiles at Sea. I'll put a link in the show notes so that you can get more information about Smiles at Sea. But Trisha and I are going to talk about one of my favorite topics, which is prevention.
And prevention is something that I think is a topic that we're all interested in, but I don't know that we always know what it means, and even how we can properly incorporate prevention into our practices. Is that a fair statement?
I think that's fair, because it doesn't have an insurance code. It doesn't have a fee, unlike a CIRAC crown that you know
right.
what the price is and the code. So prevention sometimes slips through the cracks.
Can I be... can I push a little bit on this as well?
Sure, go ahead.
Some might even need to see a business model for prevention. And I don't mean that in a cynical way. I know any of our listeners are wanting to prevent disease. Our listeners are not the kind of people that are worried that, if we prevent cavities, we're not going to have any business. Those are not listeners of the Thriving Dentist Show.
Perfect.
But I do think that a fair question is, how can I successfully incorporate prevention into my practice?
Great question, and I think we are ripe at this point to have some models coming together and testing them out in practice. I do know that there are several dentist hygienist teams that have attended my courses, and once they've learned about prevention and xylitol and what the newest approaches to prevention are, that they've actually gone back and revamped their entire practices. And their practices have changed, so they're not doing as many decay, replacement, fillings. They're doing a lot more prevention, but it hasn't changed their income.
Well, and I have to share something with you. We're certainly involved in prevention in my own practice, and I don't think there's any way to create a better patient appreciation than helping them prevent problems. Mm-hmm. Talk about turning your patients into ambassadors for your practice. There's no better way to do that.
Absolutely, and I have yet to find a single dentist who wants to put fillings in on root caries around crowns. They just don't want to do that.
They don't want to do that at all.
And they would much rather do all the elective things that patients are happy to pay for, because it's things they want.
Sure.
Things that will help them have a more beautiful smile. So
sure.
Prevention is... definitely a boost to any right. practice.
And I want to either give a compliment or a warning. I'm not sure quite what it is, but I've discovered that Trisha is a fellow nerd. And I use that as a term of endearment. I am
Thank
one
you.
Too. But we're going to get kind of deep into science. And if you like science related to prevention, you're in for a treat. So it's okay if I call you a nerd. It's a term of endearment.
Absolutely. I appreciate
yeah.
it. Thank
yeah.
you.
And I'll make one little audio disclaimer. We're actually recording this live. If you hear any background noise, there's 4,000 other people on the ship. So we might hear some background noise, but anyway, it's all good. So hey, would you mind, Trisha, sharing your backstory? I know many of our listeners will recognize your name, and they'll know who you are. But in case they don't, we do have listeners in 164 countries, so there may be some around the world that haven't heard your name. Would you be kind enough to share your backstory with our listeners?
Absolutely, and I hope there's someone in Switzerland, because I once worked in Switzerland for 4 years.
We absolutely have actually a nice community of listeners in Switzerland. So
fantastic.
Perhaps they will remember. There we go.
Well, I grew up in a family of 7 kids, and mom was a mom, stay at home, having all these kids, and dad was a police officer and eventually a chief, and I knew at age 14 or 15 that I would never, ever be a mother. It was such a hard job, because there was a 20-year span from the first child to the last. The last was 7 years old, and then the menopause baby came, and it was like... no way would I do that on purpose. I think you have to be young and married and not thinking about that.
Ah.
So I decided very early on that I would follow in my father's footsteps. So I got him aside one day and I said, Dad, I know what I want to be when I grow up. And he was so excited to hear. I said, Dad, I want to be a policewoman. And he looked at me, the smile wiped off his face. You would have thought I told him I wanted to be a prostitute. He looked at me. He shook his head. He said, Dear, you can be anything in the world you want to be, but you will not be a policewoman.
So much for encouragement on that one, huh?
I know. Uh-huh. And it wasn't until years later I realized that the two women who worked for him in the juvenile division both drank a lot and smoked a lot. So I guess he couldn't picture his firstborn daughter as a smoking alcoholic policewoman. So the next thing that happened is I fell in love with my orthodontist, who wasn't really an orthodontist. He was a general dentist who did ortho on Wednesday and Saturday, but my parents could afford it. And I was thrilled to have a beautiful smile. It was a very tiny office, one operatory, and when I would walk in the reception area, Dr. Geiser, who was my orthodontist, would see me from the his operatory. And every time I walked in, he said, "Hi, Trisha, how are you? How is the chief?" And I was so amazed that he remembered my name.
A little bit of people skills there.
Yes.
So there's a takeaway here, listeners. Notice what made an imprint on you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and of course, later I became a hygienist, and I really wondered if he remembered me or if he had a schedule and he knew who was coming in the door next. Didn't matter. He made me feel special.
Didn't matter. You were recognized.
I was. And
you
so
know, we've talked so much about the human side, the people side of dentistry, and just another example of how it made an imprint on you and in directly or indirectly impacted your career.
Absolutely. I asked him because it was so much fun to go to his office. Every patient loved him, and his walls were plastered with pictures of his patients. They would send graduation pictures, marriage, when they had a baby. He had pictures of all these smiles all over his operatory and waiting room. And I said to him one day, "What would I have to do to work in an office like yours when I grew up?" Because he had two women handing him instruments, and I thought that would be a great job. So he didn't say be an orthodontist. He didn't say be a dentist. He didn't say be a dental assistant. He said, "Trisha, you have to be a dental hygienist." Well, this was a long time ago. I graduated 51 years ago from hygiene, and the dentist I went to didn't employ a hygienist. So I thought that's what the women were who handed him instruments. So I thought, okay. I enrolled at the University of Minnesota, was accepted, and I was halfway through the first quarter when I realized I wasn't going to be a dental assistant. But I had no idea what a hygienist was. So I thought, well, I better have a plan B in case I don't make it through hygiene. And my plan B was English, because you may not remember, but long ago when they taught English, it was with diagramming sentences. And I thought that was fun. That's not how you pick a major in university.
Actually,
but
my palms are starting to sweat. I do remember this. Yes.
So my plan B was English. So by the end of the first quarter, I failed freshman English because I put periods instead of commas in the bibliography. I went to the teacher and asked her about the fact that the final paper was a failure because of that. And I asked about the other grades that were B's and C's, and wouldn't that average out to at least a passing grade? And she said, and could say this back in the 1960s, "No, those were just gifts, and you shouldn't have gotten them anyway." Oh, and I forgot to tell you, she was a communist. And I know she was a communist because she only talked about communism. She never talked about English. And I'd gone to Catholic school, and the nuns are perfect communists. So why would you want to pick that and not be a nun?
It was
So I ended up not having a plan B. I had to make it through dental hygiene and take another quarter of
kind of by default then, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
But then I wish I could find that communist English teacher and show her all the articles I've written, the book chapters I've written, and the books I've written.
you turned out all right.
I think so.
Well,
so then from there, I worked for a year, then went to Switzerland for 4 years, came back and finished my degree in higher education, taught in the dental school in the perio department of Minnesota, did expanded functions in Arizona, and then took a position teaching at the University of Washington, and lots of clinical practice, lots of perio. Arizona passed their law in 1975 allowing hygienists to do local anesthesia, surgical curettage, suturing, and scaling and root planing. So I did lots of that, and now I'm also a faculty member at the University of Louisville for the hygiene department.
Very cool.
So lots of hats. I sort of have felt like a migrant tooth worker every 4 years someplace else.
And you have, we'll talk more about it as we go on this interview, but you have created a very cool educational institution called O'Hehir University. And we'll talk more about that.
Perfect.
But you are a devout educator. So I'm so thrilled to have you on the show. Let's dive into my favorite topic, which is prevention. And, you know, if I can make an opening statement, I think our healthcare system's broken. And dentistry is part of that. And why I say that is that if you look on the medical side, it's about, fixing something that's diseased or broken. And it's not so much about finding the root cause that caused the problem and preventing it, but it's about fixing something that has manifested itself as broken. It's a cynical definition, but is it accurate?
Totally accurate, absolutely. And it's more about treating symptoms instead of actually treating the cause.
Right.
Some people had told me that medicine is much more preventive oriented, and I really didn't believe that because I think at least in dentistry and dental hygiene, hygiene is based on prevention. So I went to all of the diagnostic codes for medicine and searched through, and it's pages and pages and thousands of pages. And within the diagnostic codes for medicine, there is only one code for anyone healthy.
Oh, my goodness.
It's a well baby checkup. Everything else, you have to have a disease, a symptom, or a condition in order to be seen.
So it sort of feeds that model.
Totally.
And dentistry can also be very much that way. It's about fixing something that's broken. Mm-hmm. And yet not being able to go to the root cause of what caused that dysfunction.
Right.
I think I was first introduced to the subject of prevention posthumously by Dr. Bob Barkley. And he was the founder of the American Society for Preventive Dentistry. And so he was pioneering some things in the 50s and 60s that, frankly, we're still trying to catch up to. But let's talk about prevention. And let's talk about it in the dental context. Just so we have common definitions and we're on the same page, what does prevention mean to you?
Prevention means keeping healthy people healthy. Starting out healthy, everyone starts out healthy, but we don't keep them healthy. And the system is set up to have them come back when they have disease.
Well, you had me at hello. Keeping people healthy, mm-hmm. right? I mean, it sounds self-evident. Aren't we all interested in that?
Right, but because we're so focused on restorative care or periodontal care, that we kind of wait until people have disease before we jump in and do something.
Right.
We don't jump in and say, okay, we want to prevent the very first cavity from ever forming. We want people to come in and get the cavities filled, but to actually continually see people and create a cavity-free group of patients, it hasn't really happened in this country.
Let's get scientific for our listeners. I've learned so much from you. In the time that we spent together on this cruise. Also had a chance to spend some time with Nate Jones. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about Nate a little bit and his company. And I've also had a chance to experience a product here on this cruise that I'm kind of excited about. But let's get a little nerdy and talk mm-hmm. about science. And one thing I'd like to talk about specifically is xylitol. Can we take a little deep dive into xylitol and how that might fit in a prevention model?
Absolutely. And to me, xylitol is the biggest game changer for dental hygiene in my 51 years.
Okay, so...
Biggest game changer.
You just made a very bold statement. Mm-hmm. By the way, I think you're right. Back that up.
Very simply, if you give someone xylitol several times a day, 3 to 5 times a day, in the first study they did in 1970, just 4 days, and they just put it in coffee and tea and some candies they fed these people, they reduced plaque by 50%.
50.
50. And this wasn't just disclosing yes or no plaque. They actually scrape every bit of plaque off the teeth and weigh it wet and weigh it dry. So they have a very objective measure, and they saw 50% reduction. Well, everybody, this was in Finland. They got so excited, they told all of their research friends in other countries, and they began researching, and then repeated the study in 72 and got the same results with no oral hygiene, that they could reduce plaque 50%.
Just in case we have listeners that aren't familiar with xylitol, can you describe what xylitol is?
Absolutely. Xylitol is a natural sugar taken originally from the bark of birch trees, but now the primary source is corn cobs and corn stalk. Not the corn, but the corn cobs and the corn stalk. Xylitol is actually taken from fibers, so it's digested in the body as a fiber. It doesn't use insulin, doesn't even raise the insulin. So, the way that it works in the mouth is pretty amazing. the bacteria, in order to form a biofilm, talk to each other. So just imagine on the right-hand inside lingual surface between the last two molars, you can kind of feel a little protected area there, saliva. The bacteria are floating there, and they have to talk to each other before they can attach to the tooth surface. And it's called quorum sensing. They have to have a quorum, and they send out a little boomerang chemical, and if it locks into a docking station on another bacteria and doesn't come back, the bacteria knows there's somebody else there. If it bounces back, then they're waiting until there are more bacteria. When they have a quorum, all of the bacteria know at the same moment they all squirt out polysaccharide slime that attaches to the tooth surface, and that's how biofilm starts forming. What the xylitol can do is block those docking stations. So the bacteria keep sending out the chemicals, but they aren't getting the communication. It breaks down the communication, blocks the docking stations. They think there aren't other bacteria around. And this happens once the biofilm is formed on the tooth surface as well. The bacteria keep talking to each other within the biofilm to make sure the neighbors are still there, so they still make the slime to stick to the tooth surface. But if you have xylitol in the mouth, this is how you can reduce it by 50%, by just interfering with that communication, and half of the bacteria are just going to go, my neighbor's left, I'll leave too, and they simply stop making the sticky stuff to attach. Another way that the xylitol works is that the bacteria have an outer membrane and an inner membrane. The xylitol molecule goes in through that first membrane but doesn't have the key to get through the next one. What happens is the bacteria has to turn on its own membrane pump and pump that molecule out using its own energy, but it'll turn around and come back in. And what happens is the bacteria can't utilize it, can't metabolize the xylitol, gets no energy from it, and therefore can't make any acid from it. And the sugar and the sorbitol and the mannitol, all of these other sugars, and even sugar other ones that are sugar alcohols, not alcohol, but the molecular structure, they can be metabolized by the bacteria and produce acid. And that's what then causes the tooth decay.
So really, it's changing the microflora in the mouth.
It's not attacking the bacteria like an antibiotic would or an antimicrobial. Bacteria don't like to be attacked. They will...
Defend?
Absolutely, they will defend, and they will figure out clever ways to defend. But if you just knock down the communication lines, or the xylitol does something else, it elevates the pH. So if you elevate the pH in the mouth, the bacteria that like to produce acid like to live in acid. And if you bump that pH up to an alkaline level, those bacteria go, oh, I don't like it here anymore. The neighborhood has changed, I'm leaving.
Wow.
So very simple ways that the xylitol works that don't result in resistant bacterial strains. It just changes the neighborhood.
We talked a little bit about Nate Jones, and he shared the story about his father, a physician.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things his dad was committed to was not over-prescribing antibiotic. And I think all in dentistry were sensitive to that because of the fear of creating resistant bacteria and superbugs.
Exactly.
So certainly we don't want to be cavalier about recommending antibiotic. And if you ever go to the physician and you're not feeling well and your physician says, oh, I don't even need to know what's going on, here's an antibiotic, we're probably on the wrong track.
Absolutely. What's happened, interestingly enough, is dentistry and dental hygiene know about biofilms and multi-species biofilms with hundreds and thousands of different species of bacteria living in the mouth. Medicine is only just learning this.
Right.
Because they...
We're really ahead of it.
Way ahead. Because what they are now finding is that ear infections are caused by a biofilm in the eustachian tube. And when they give a systemic antibiotic, it only tones down the biofilm for a while. The bacteria go, okay, there's an antibiotic on board. We'll put a crust around the biofilm and tell the inner bacteria to stop replicating and just wait until the bacteria is out of the system. As soon as the antibiotic is out of the system, then they turn their genes back on for replication. And it looks like there's a new ear infection when, in fact, it's the same one. And when I ask audiences how many have had a kid with an ear infection, they all raise their hand.
Everyone raises
their hand. I said, keep your hands up. How many gave an antibiotic? The hands all stay up. And then I say, how many got over the ear infection only to have another one a month later? And there. The hands are all up. So the antibiotic doesn't do well with a multi-species biofilm. Another area where they found that the biofilm is something that they had not really counted on is with open wounds, bed sores and open wounds. And on the feet of people with diabetes, they often have open wounds, and the primary treatment up until now has been amputation. They keep giving them systemic antibiotics, but they aren't actually healing because the surface of that open wound, if you could look with a microscope, is a biofilm because it's wet and gooey, and the biofilm will form on that surface. And what they found is just using xylitol on that surface can actually heal these open wounds.
I think our listeners are probably most familiar of xylitol in a chewing gum format. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about other products? I learned about these this week, and I want to share them with our listeners, one of them being a nasal spray. But can you talk a little bit about some other xylitol products that can be part of a prevention regimen?
Perfect. Let me just back up and explain why they're in chewing gum at this point.
Please.
The first study they did was a total meal replacement study where they actually sweetened all the food with xylitol, sucrose, or fructose.
So xylitol can be used as a natural sweetener.
Right.
In place of processed sugar.
Exactly. It looks like sugar. It feels like sugar.
It's granular.
Exactly. It tastes like sugar. It has a little cooling sensation, which actually pulls fluid out of the mouth and makes the mouth wetter, which for people with dry mouth, it's very good. But once they did this two-year study and showed an 85% reduction in tooth decay, they realized they couldn't really convince everybody to switch to xylitol for everything. So they thought, well, let's just put it in chewing gum and have people chew it after meals and snacks. And they did that study and found...
Kind of like an easy pathway.
Yes.
Way to get it introduced to the population.
And get it into the biofilm and counteract the sugars from the meals. And they got the same results. So that's why we see it in chewing gum. And lots of the studies have been done with chewing gum, especially looking at caries. But there are other ways to deliver it to the mouth. Toothpaste, mouth rinse, mints, even a gel. A gel that's great for kids, but also a gel that works great for dry mouth as well. And a spray that I have right here, just in case I get a dry throat talking.
So that was in our welcome packet for all the speakers and attendees at this Smiles at Sea program. Mm-hmm. And literally, it's right in front of me.
Actually, this is the throat spray. You have the
nasal spray.
So my mistake.
Right. So you have the throat spray.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about the nasal spray and how this relates to prevention.
It's the nose is connected, and the nose, the throat, and the mouth are all connected.
ENT, right? Right?
Your nose and throat, you're right. Very good. And I'll start it with right in the practice. Hygienists really have a hard time when patients want to breathe through their mouth during the procedure, and they're using a power scaler with water, and the patient's trying to breathe through their mouth. They're coughing and choking.
Yeah, that's not working out so good.
No, it isn't. So what they can do is actually have these samples of the nasal spray, the clear nasal spray, to have the patient spray their nose, which what that will do, the xylitol will pull fluid out of swollen tissues. It'll wash the nose like washing your hands, and it then coats the nose to make it easier to breathe. So you can have a patient use it in the office, have them breathe through their nose and not breathe through their mouth.
What a cool way to introduce the concept. Mm-hmm. And I think we're learning a lot more about the consequences of mouth breathing. In fact, we had a wonderful conversation in the gym Trisha, and our listeners know that I'm a runner. I'm a long distance runner, and you asked me when I'm running if I breathe through my nose or through my mouth, and I had to think about it. And as I thought about it, I said, it's kind of a combination, but there are times where I'm feeling fatigued and I think I'm breathing through my mouth. And you shared some great science with me.
Mm-hmm. We're meant to be nose breathers, and the important part about that is you take the air in slowly and you exhale it slowly, and the oxygen is actually absorbed on the exhale, not the inhale. So that's why it's important to exhale slowly through the nose. The other, to me, most fascinating aspect of nose breathing is when you breathe through your nose, the air goes through the sinuses and into the lungs, and it takes nitric oxide with it that's produced in the sinuses, which allows for 10 to 18% more oxygen to be absorbed into the blood.
So all this was really interesting. And then when Trisha got to that point, she had my rapt attention. Because as an athlete, I know that the more oxygen flow I have, mm-hmm. the better performance I'm going to. So she hasn't guaranteed me a 30-second per mile improvement in my half marathon time. But I am anticipating some really good results.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I see a rolfer in Phoenix who loves to bike, and he was a mouth breather. And as we've talked about this, and he's been using the nasal spray, he made a conscious effort with his biking to breathe through his nose, and close his mouth.
Right.
But he found in the very first days that he was biking slower. But he stuck with it, and it only took 2 weeks, and he didn't even notice. But by the end of 2 weeks, he was biking twice as far in the same amount of time. He couldn't believe that it had made that much difference. But getting more oxygen to your muscles gives you more stamina, more endurance, and more muscle memory. And the important part, too, of not exhaling the CO2 too quickly and keeping more of that in, the CO2 is important for muscle cramping.
Right, right.
And so people who get cramps when they're running are probably breathing through their mouth.
Right. So let's bring this back to the dental office. So now we have multiple products. So I'll recap. We have chewing gum, mints, rinse. We have toothpaste, and nasal and throat spray, all of, containing xylitol. Is there any risk to xylitol? Is there any byproduct or any risk to xylitol?
Actually, xylitol is a molecule the body even makes in the metabolism of other carbohydrates. So it is natural to the body, so from that perspective, no. But because it is a fiber and digested as a fiber, if you switch your... if you cut out all sugar and add xylitol in all of your cooking, everyone who does that has made the mistake in the beginning to eat too much too quickly. Mm. And if you do that, you will experience gas and bloating and maybe watery diarrhea.
Right.
Now, once you get used to it, that's not a problem. And in the study where they replaced it all, they just introduced it slowly. Now, think about this. The place where people could really benefit from some diarrhea would be in a nursing home where they're all constipated from all their medications.
There we go.
So they thought, this would be perfect. This is going to help.
A natural laxative.
Yes. So they laced all the food with xylitol, put it in the coffee and tea, and for 2 weeks everything was flowing well. But at the end of 2 weeks, everybody got used to it and they were all constipated.
Right, there we
so
go
it's
back
a very,
to that.
Very short-term effect. Another... warning about it is don't let your pets eat xylitol. For dogs, it's not good. They can suffer some liver damage. And the interesting part about when dogs eat xylitol, it does trigger the release of insulin. So the solution, if your dog eats xylitol, is to give them sugar. That will bring the insulin down. And if you wait and take them to the vet will do an IV of glucose. So that's the quick fix for that. But there's so many foods that dogs shouldn't be eating.
Right, absolutely. So let's talk about applications in practice.
Mm-hmm.
Share your thoughts about how this could be integrated in a practice that wants to emphasize prevention.
I think every practice would like to have prevention because of keeping all of the teeth healthy after the restorative dentistry has been done, and that the best way to do that is to reduce the biofilm by 50%. We also know from the research that people can't even brush half the plaque off their teeth. So if you can get it off with this, thinking of all the different groups who aren't very good at even cleaning their teeth, little kids, teenagers, elderly, all of the people.
I believe those are called people.
Oh, yes. all of them, right. All ages.
Everyone.
Yes.
I'm joking, but... You know, sometimes we see patients that we're not quite sure are on a first-name basis with their toothbrush.
Exactly.
And, you know, it's let's just face it, it's a challenge. And,
it is.
You know, I love it when we give, home care instruction and we give information. But some of those behaviors are hard to change.
And just giving information does not equate to behavior change.
Right.
That has to come from the patient's side. And we tend to not ask very many open-ended questions because we from my perspective when I was a hygienist, what we were taught is the fire hose approach. Just give them everything you've got and see if anything sticks.
I'm not sure much has changed.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Help us with that. Help us with some open-ended questions.
Part of what we teach at O'Hare University, it's a degree in oral health promotion, and it's all about behavior change. So some fun open-ended questions to ask patients. One is, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being the lowest, 10 being the highest, how healthy is your mouth? And that gives us an indication of where people are. And you'd be surprised how many people say 8, no matter what their mouth looks like. Everybody wants to be healthy and thinks they're being
perception,
healthy.
Correct?
Right. Mm-hmm.
The difference between perception and reality.
Mm-hmm.
There.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Another one is, instead of asking people, do you floss? Because we all know the answer is no, so why do we even ask? Another fun question to ask is, tell me what you use to clean between your teeth. The answers can be a bent paper clip, a business card, a Swiss Army knife, but nothing that you've actually endorsed as
right.
a good interdental cleaner.
Right.
And then the fun one to ask, if you've asked a yes or no question and then you realize, oh, that was yes or no, the way to follow up is to simply say, that's interesting, tell me more about why you think that. Tell
love
me
that.
More about why you think that, to get some feedback from patients.
I love the exercise of asking questions, and I love the engagement that you get in that dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
It's so valuable.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. what I would also recommend is throw out the lecture. Don't do any more lectures to patients about oral hygiene. Most of them glaze over anyway. They aren't listening. But instead, simply ask permission to even give the instruction.
What does that sound like?
That sounds like any hygienist giving lecture, instead of saying, okay, this is where you need to brush better, this is where you need to clean better, start out by saying, do I have your permission to talk to you about toothbrushing or cleaning between your teeth?
Absolutely.
But one of our students did that study. She asked 9 people in a row, do I have your permission to give you some oral hygiene instructions? 9 people. 7 flat out said no, and the other 3 said, only if you want to do it.
Okay.
So patients don't want to hear it. Instead, it's better to find a problem to solve. And I like to keep all of that education a secret, because people like secrets. And one way is, they don't really want to hear about toothbrushing. They've been brushing their teeth their whole life. You don't need to teach me. I know how to do that. And what we're finding is the biggest problem is toothpaste. Because toothpaste numbs the tongue and tricks people into thinking their teeth are clean when they really aren't. Creates so many bubbles, they can't see where they're putting their brush. And the worst is that they really think, because they're drooling and daydreaming with their eyes closed, that they brushed for 3 minutes when it's in fact been 30 seconds. So instead of teaching toothbrushing, what you can say to the patient, especially patients who come with lingual calculus and need to have that removed, and it seems almost every patient has that, ask the patient, do you like it when I have to use very sharp pointy instruments to scrape all this tartar off your teeth?
Now that you mention it, not really.
No, most people don't like it. And then you can say, I know a secret. And if I tell you the secret and you follow this, you will never have to have that scraping ever again.
Oh, I love this.
And the patients are anxious. They want to know, because they don't like the scraping, but they don't think it's related to what they're doing. So all you have to say is, the secret is, start brushing on the inside of the bottom teeth first. No water and no toothpaste. Brush the inside of the bottom teeth first and brush all of your teeth until they feel clean and taste clean. Only then add toothpaste. What happens is, they actually have to brush evenly throughout their mouth, because they're using their tongue now to feel where the plaque is. And they brush until their teeth feel clean and taste clean, and they'll actually spend more time and brush more effectively without even realizing it.
That's a behavioral, you've introduced a behavioral change.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Which is more likely to last,
mm-hmm.
and develop into a pattern that is more likely to stick, isn't it?
Exactly. And within that pattern is built in a way for them to measure their success. And the measuring is with their tongue. And I've done the research on this, and written the cartoon book, The Toothpaste Secret, with lots of cartoons about it. But we did this with 125 patients. Hygienists all around the country. I was writing perio reports at the time, a summary of the research. Did that for 26 years, so readers participated. All they measured was bleeding and bleeding and calculus on the lower linguals, and just quick index, and they had patients who were then at their next recall came in to see. But now, as you know, with some patients, they agreed to do this and they forgot. So not everybody remembered, but when we averaged all of the data together, we saw a 63% reduction in calculus and a 55% reduction in bleeding on the lower lingual, simply telling them to start there and brush without toothpaste. So it doesn't have to be complicated or, involved. It can be very simple. Prevention is very simple.
And sometimes the best breakthroughs are simple. You know, doctors, if you're listening to this on your own, this is clearly an episode that I'd want you to share with your team members. Share this with your hygiene team members. Share this with your assistants. Share it with your front desk team members. In fact, this would be a great episode to play in a team meeting and involve the entire team so you're all on the same page.
Yes, and everybody can get out a toothbrush and
there
dry brush while they're listening.
Well, if we're going to be representing health,
we have to start with ourselves.
So, Trisha, we're talking about xylitol. Let's bring this back to xylitol.
Yes, and since it's difficult for patients to actually remove all the plaque by themselves, the xylitol makes it easier for them and makes them much more successful. And one thing you'll find patients saying when they think they've done everything we've told them to do, and then when they use the toothpaste and it gives them a false sense of being effective, their first response is, well, I've done everything you told me. It must be genetic. And that's what we hear a lot. So we need to give patients tools that will make them feel more successful, and the xylitol will do that. And if they have 5 exposures a day, that will be enough to help keep the bacterial biofilm under control. And it's easy enough to do with a mouthwash and toothpaste morning and evening, and then chewing gum or mints after meals and snacks.
So that's what I was going to say. We have the application of the chewing gum, the mints, rinse,
and toothpaste.
It wouldn't be difficult to get 5 applications.
No, it isn't. And the kids love the taste of the candies and the gums. And the gums, the flavor, once the flavor is gone, all the xylitol's been released. So it's a therapeutic gum. You only chew it for 5 minutes. You don't chew it like recreational gum has aspartame in it that you really don't want, that keeps the flavor all day long. So once the flavor's gone, they don't need to be chewing it anymore.
There you go.
And one little myofunctional tip is to take 2 pieces at a time to get enough xylitol. See how long you can chew them separately, 1 on each side.
Oh, hey, there we go.
There's a little test for you.
I can picture some hygienists wanting to test that out right now.
Yeah, I bet, yes.
Very, very good.
And it helps for patients then who say they can't chew gum or anything because of their TMJ, but in most cases they're just chewing on one side, but if you get them to do it on both, they balance.
There you go. Let's talk about some applications, and I realize that in some ways we're still trying to figure this out in the practice.
Yes, absolutely.
Let's just give our listeners some examples of how they might apply this in their practice. One way that comes to my mind would be to distribute these products to our patients.
Absolutely.
Whether we sell them to them, gift them, whatever it is that we do, but we could distribute those. Is that a possible application?
That's a great application, and the Spry company has what they call the dental defense system, which is a packet that comes with the toothpaste, the mouth rinse, chewing gum, and candies, so that you have enough for a month to do. So you could have.
So it comes in a kit, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about Spry. I think we're introducing Spry to our listeners.
Mm-hmm.
They may not be familiar with them. I met one of their founders here at this meeting, and I'm kind of excited about their products. Talk about Spry.
Spry is the dental arm of the Clear company, XLEAR, which is the nasal spray was the first product, and then people kept asking for more dental products. So that's when Nathan put together the Spry company with lots of different products for the dental office to focus on oral health.
Right.
And so the products are all 100% xylitol sweetened. You won't find sorbitol, maltitol, any of the other sugars in there. And their goal is to have their products at a neutral pH. And many products actually are below 7, which is neutral, and are even below 5.5, which is what will demineralize the enamel. And we want to have products. So it's a good thing to check the pH.
So very pure.
Very pure products, very very committed to prevention. And it's a company that's really dedicated to really educating and reaching hygienists, because they really feel that the hygienists are the preventive experts in the dental practice.
And another dental company headquartered in Utah.
Yes.
Is that correct? I believe. Is it Provo?
Yes. Well, I think the company is in American Fork.
American Fork, yes.
Mm-hmm. And Nathan lives in Provo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Very cool. So just like it sounds, S-P-R-Y.
Mm-hmm.
I'll put a link in the show notes.
Okay.
You called it a dental...
A DDS, a dental defense system.
I like the acronym, mm-hmm. dental defense system. Mm-hmm. So we could distribute that.
You can distribute that. You could sell that. You could... I would build it right into the practice of, if you really want patients, if patients want to be offered the opportunity never to have tooth decay.
Right.
And if you can get them on these products, that's pretty much a guarantee that if they use this, that you can assure them that they're not going to have decay.
It
involves a bit more coaching on the part of the hygienist to explain what this is, how it works, and why it's important to get the 5 exposures each day. And what patients realize as soon as they start doing this, their teeth feel better because they've reduced that communication between the bacteria in the mouth.
So when that happens, compliance goes up.
Absolutely, because people see and feel the results.
Yeah, I imagine that this is a system that you would probably get better compliance from, because the patient's feeling the benefits.
Right, and it's sweet.
And control. Mm-hmm. Well, there you go.
So you can actually either sell the products in the practice, or if you have a health food store nearby, you can recommend that they go there. In European offices, the dental supply companies actually sell cabinets complete with all the products. And dental offices sell all the products they want their patients to use. But in the United States, we kind of shy away from that. I think it would be better to have products available. It'd be nice to have the patients stop by the office just to buy things to feel a part of the practice and not just go there for it.
Well, and compliance is going to go up, because if they have to go elsewhere, although they are distributed in some common areas, Whole Foods?
Whole Foods, Vitamin Shops, Sprouts, different health food
health-oriented,
stores.
Health-oriented, more specialty stores.
The nasal spray is in almost all the stores now except Walgreens. It's in CVS, Walmart, Target. So the nasal spray is a great one to start with.
Right. But I like the idea of distributing the office, because you've removed one more hurdle of them having to go somewhere else and acquire it. Well, I like the idea of distributing the office, because it's one less hurdle that the patient has to jump over, and it makes it easier. And I think this can be priced in such a way that's very fair. We don't necessarily need to make a big profit from this, but we can cover our costs.
Definitely, it's a way to cover costs until we figure out how to actually charge for coaching, oral health coaching. People pay for executive coaching and athletic coaching and life coaching. I foresee in the future they'll be paying for oral health coaching as well, so that it's not just coming in to have the calculus removed from the teeth, but more of talking to patients about oral health. And we're finding out more and more how bad sugar is.
Right.
And the reason xylitol is so effective is that sugar is so bad.
Yeah.
And when we see dental disease in the mouth, we equate it to the sugar. But what we don't realize is that there are lots of other systemic diseases that are implicated because of the sugar. And so we're seeing diabetes, heart disease, and cancer. So people need help with how to cut sugar out of the diet. And dental offices have the hardest time, because we believe as dental professionals that if we do a good job of our oral hygiene, we can eat as much sugar as we want. And in the break room of every dental office is more sugar than I've ever seen before.
Most offices I've discovered have a secret stash.
Aha!
I've discovered.
You've discovered.
Through investigative reporting, I've discovered this.
So in your practice, do they have sweets in the break room?
We're actually pretty darn good about this. We do not have sweets in the break room.
Good.
One of the things I've been working on in my own health journey, is to cut all processed sugar. And I don't know that I can say that completely because it sneaks up on you.
Well, even table salt has sugar in it.
I was going to say.
It from sticking together.
Yeah.
So dextrose and sugar.
But in terms of any obvious processed sugar, I've cut that out.
Good for you.
In the last year. And
how do you feel?
I feel fantastic. It's helped me in my fitness. It's helped me in my just general health and how I feel about things and energy and don't have the ups and downs. And I was never a big candy person or sweets person, but it kind of snuck up on me. I mean, I'll give you an example. I'll call it out. I enjoyed, I have to use this in the past, Starbucks hot chocolate. Now, little did I know how much sugar was in a Venti Starbucks hot chocolate. Trisha, do you have any idea?
Oh, gosh, no, but I bet it's a lot.
About a day and a half worth. And if it was a cool day, I might have two.
Ooh.
Well, there's 3 days' worth of sugar intake just on that alone. So it kind of sneaks up on you a little bit.
And it sneaks up, too, in flour, because what people don't realize is flour is just a long-chain sugar.
Right.
And what they're finding now with kids, the number one cause of tooth decay in kids are goldfish crackers.
Mm.
They stick to the teeth even worse than sugary.
And that's, you know, you'd think it's caramels, you know, sticky candy. Nope, goldfish. you go.
But you can see how many things, how many topics around coaching and prevention that hygienists could be involved with. And adding to that what we're learning about mouth breathing and trying to help, I foresee us having an opportunity in the future if we can figure out the models of how it could work.
Pardon my enthusiasm, but this is a great time to be in our profession.
Oh, it is.
And new challenges, new ways to help people become healthier. I introduced the idea of your university a little bit ago. Tell us about O'Hehir University, and I'd love our listeners to learn more.
Thanks. I'd be happy to. Dental hygiene education has been focused so much on a two-year degree, and the accreditation has required a two-year entry to practice. But they've added all kinds of courses into that. And I was studying myofunctional therapy and buteyko breathing and interacting with speech pathologists who looked at me and said, "You're a hygienist. That's a two-year program. You shouldn't be doing this." And I'm thinking, it's not a two-year program. I have my bachelor's, I have my master's, and I even wanted to say to them, "And you can't even recognize ankyloglossia. Well, you shouldn't do it."
Touché.
So I went back.
Not to mention how many hours of postgraduate education you have.
Yes, exactly. So I went back and I took the community college dental hygiene programs in Arizona in the Maricopa Community Colleges, and I compared that to speech pathology. And do you know that those associate degree hygienists take enough contact hours to match the master's degree in speech pathology? Not the bachelor's or not an associate's. So I did a bigger study, and it's recently been published in the International Journal of Dental Hygiene, looking at community college dental hygiene programs from Maricopa, comparing it to 72 years ago, and to looking at how many hours they have. And those programs graduate associate degree hygienists with 143 contact hours of credit. That's seven short of a master's degree. So to me, it was educational malpractice that these hygienists should be recognized to at least a bachelor degree level. But when hygienists go on to get that bachelor's degree, it's $20,000 to $30,000 and two or three more years on top of 143 contact hours. So hygienists know that they've done more than an English major or a psych major. So we created a six-month program that's completely online and recognizing all the credits they have, but giving them some skills that will make them indispensable in a clinical practice, behavior change, action research. How can you test things out in your practice? If I change this about how I work with my patient, will they get healthier? So a way to actually start measuring things. They all have to do a research project and a final paper. They cram a lot into 6 months. It's designed for very busy hygienists with busy family lives. We meet once a week or eventually every other week in a video conference. So hygienists are people, and they don't want to just go online and read and write. They talk to each other, so our class size is 5 to 6 students, meeting online. We've had graduates, we've had over 200 graduates, and they're all from all over the world.
I think you might have facilitated a couple of those sessions while we were here.
Yes, I did. I taught 2 classes yesterday.
And you missed out on some fun because you were working.
I was working. I missed out on a little sunshine, but it was, the classes were fun too. So, yeah. And you can do the classes anywhere as long as I have an internet connection. My partner is Tim Ives, who is in the UK, so we balance out who's teaching the classes.
Wonderful.
And it's fun to have the students say to us, and we have 3 of our graduates here on the cruise, and they've said that it's a life-changing experience, and they learn how to think differently to get different results is what they tell us.
Trisha, I know that our listeners are going to want to get in touch with you. Mm-hmm. Could you be kind enough to share some website addresses, first of all? Mm-hmm. Would you share the website address for SPRI?
I think it's spry.com or clear, X-L-E-A-R.com. We'll get you both to those.
I will do the research.
Thank
and
you.
In the show notes, you can go to thrivingdentist.com. I will have the link to Clear or Spry, and you can simply click on that. It'll take you right there. How about the link to O'Hehir University?
You can get to it 2 ways. OHU-EDU.com, because O'Hehir is a little tricky to spell.
Right. OHU.EDU.
OHU-EDU.com.
Okay.
And otherwise it's O'HehirUniversity.com. But
and spell that out if you
will. It's O-H-E-H-I-R. University. It's the old Gaelic spelling.
Perfect. And again, I'll put that. If you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I will put that in the show notes. In one click, they can go directly there. I know that you all have inspired some hygienists to reach out to you. Would you be kind enough to share your email address?
Absolutely. They can reach me at Trisha, T-R-I-S-H-A, at OHU-EDU.com.
Perfect. And again, I'll put that in the show notes. If you're a hygienist listening to this, I know that you're going to want to connect with Trisha, whether it be about prevention or any topic at all related to hygiene and education. I know you've got a great friend to reach out to in Trisha. So, Trisha, let me take a minute and thank you. Thanks for your passion. Thanks for your commitment to being better tomorrow than we are today.
Thank you.
And thanks for being committed to the whole concept of prevention. I share that interest, and I look forward to the day when we're helping people become healthier instead of just fixing problems. And I think we've done some pioneering work here today. I hope we've inspired our listeners to take some action on some of this. Maybe start with themselves.
Absolutely.
Take some action.
And I could offer a little gift to your listeners.
Please.
I have a little website that I have. I just have my lecture information and some secrets on, called onlineoralhealth.com. And if they search around, they can get a free digital copy of the toothpaste secret.
Oh, cool. And again, share that website address if you would.
It's onlineoralhealth.com.
Onlineoralhealth.com. Awesome. Thank you. And I love the concept of a secret. Thanks for sharing your secrets with us.
You're welcome.
Let me take a minute and thank our listeners. We love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but we try never to lose track of the fact that we couldn't do it without you. There's 3 ways you can support our work. Number 1, you can tell a colleague. You probably know someone that's never heard the word podcast. Enlighten them about it and share the Thriving Dentist Show with them. Secondly, you can write us a review. You can jump on iTunes and write us a review. That helps us in the same way that, say, a Google review would help your practice. And the third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes or Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. If you hit the subscribe button, that means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll automatically go to your listening device. Let me close by saying thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you that I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big. as big as the ocean blue. When you dream it might come true, when you dream, dream big.